Good morning. Some people ask every once in a while about music we play. I've been playing Asian drums this morning. We've been doing this for like 18 years, so, but off and on. So fun music if anybody's interested. Calendar. We're going to make a few changes. We're not doing this anymore. No, that's not the change. Hi, YouTube. We're the only church in the universe that plays the Doobie Brothers to start services. Only place. Prove me wrong. Cool. All right. But we're going to try to limit some of these announcements. I'll go through them really quickly sometimes. But if people want to make announcements, they're going to please try to come through me and we'll try to just zoom through them. Otherwise, people get tired of hearing all the announcements, even though we got lots of stuff going on all the time. Calendar's always filled. So, Shigong always starts services in the back. This is Christopher Sunday, so he's here. That's a good thing. Emotion Code with Crystal on Monday. Interchange on Wednesday. Sandra and William. Intuitive Tarot on Thursday. ARE on Thursday. And also, Christopher's doing a death and dying discussion on Saturday, next Saturday at 1 o'clock. So if you're interested to know what that might entail, talk to this guy. So, and then, of course, we have our little write in on the back. And Ginny did it this month, so that's cool. So, we do have a couple patron saints by the name of George Carlin and John Lennon. So, again, probably the only church in the universe that has these two guys as their patron saints. So, and John said, a dream you dream alone is only a dream. A dream or dream you dream together is reality. Right. And George is equally as insightful. I think it's the duty of a comedian to find out where the line is drawn and cross it deliberately. So, he did a good job of that. So, more t-shirts. I thought growing old would take longer. That's right. Books, because reality is overrated. I can't adult today. Please don't make me adult. So, and I can't read that. Math, it's all fun and games until somebody divides by zero. And, Heidi, first front page of the Herald today. Her name was the first name on the article, in fact. So, good job. So, raisin cookies that look like chocolate chip cookies are the main reason I have trust issues. They have to have that one. So, a bibliophobia, the fear of running out of books to read. Yeah, you'll never run out of books to read. That's the nice thing about that. So, an army of sheep led by a lion would defeat an army of lions led by a sheep. It's an Arab proverb. So, any class is all right if it will only let the others be so. So, a military operation. Yeah, we'll do that one next week. If the entire, and this book was written actually a number of years ago now, so if the entire population of China were to walk past you in single file, you would not live long enough to see the end. And that was a few million people ago. Yeah, maybe if they ran, we might get close, but yeah. Mike, where's Mike? Oh God! I know he was here today. Why is he not right there? What are you doing over there? This one's for you, okay? Joseph Louis Lussac, 1778 to 1850, the most noted French chemist of his generation, was the natural person to consult about any odd substance. One of his fellow scientists experimenting with ashes from burned seaweed had isolated a strange grayish black solid. He had no idea what it might be or whether it would prove any use, so he sent a specimen to the Sorbonne, which is the French school. next to the Seine. I know, my sister went there for a while, so. There, Lussac studied the queer stuff and concluded it to be a new element. At ordinary temperatures, he found it to behave in staid fashion. But when heated to a quantity of 185 degrees, it changed to a state of blue-violet vapor. There was a striking resemblance between the color of the odd gas and that of the chemist's favorite flower, the violet. It was customary to base scientific names upon Greek words, so the Frenchman took iode, the classic name for the common violet, and bestowed it upon his discovery. Sir Humphrey Davy, experimenting with iode, found it to have many valuable properties. Its flower-based name modified to iodine. The new chemical became a standard weapon in the war against bacteria. Wow. So, you bet. Interesting, huh? You can go back to work and show people how much you know. They already know it. They already know you know stuff. Good judgment comes from bad experience, and a lot of that comes from bad judgment.
Yeah.
So, the quickest way, I did these ones. Duct tape is like the Force. It has a light side and a dark side, and it holds the universe together. And there are two theories to arguing with women. Neither one works. And the question is, will that get me in trouble now or later? So, yes, yes. Catholic priest, Bordeaux, opened the morning newspaper and was dumbfounded to read in the obituary column that he had died. He quickly phoned his best friend, Landry. Did you see the papers, asked Bordeaux? They said I died. Yes, I saw it, replied Landry. Where are you calling from? A parish priest is driving down to New Orleans from Alexandria and gets stopped for speeding. The state trooper smells alcohol in the priest's breath and then sees an empty wine bottle on the floor of the car. He says, sir, have you been drinking? Just water, the priest says. The trooper says, then why do you smell like wine? The priest looks down at the bottle and says, good Lord, he did it again. I wonder if it worked. Probably not. And for all of you people on YouTube, we are now officially not below zero anymore. We are in our official thawing mode, and I have no longer a long sleeve sweater. It's great. It's just great. So, hey, let's sing a song. Kathy Tricoli, Go Light Your World.
Oh, you're giving me that look, aren't you? Giving me that look.
You know, I can't even call this gentleman our guest speaker. I mean, that would just be almost an insult anymore. Christopher's been doing this for, I've completely lost track, at least 10 years for sure, probably longer than that. And it took us literally years to convince him to do it at all. Because of some previous things in his career, and he just didn't want to start doing that again. But he graciously accepted one day, many, many, many moons ago, and has come back every single month, pretty much, except when you're bow hunting. Don't come back on that month, but everything else. And we are so grateful and honored to have you. Christopher.
Thank you, Phil. Be careful. Great song choice, by the way, Phil. Excellent.
Namaste.
Good morning. The reason they had such a hard time getting me to convince me to come down and speak many, many, many years ago was I was always very concerned about messing with somebody else's karma. So because of that, I was always very careful what I said and how I said it, because I did not want to influence a person one way or the other. We have to make our own choices. We walk this path by ourselves. I still feel that way today. I'm still very careful about what I say and how I say it. So having said that, I decided, okay, I need to step out here and do this. And this song that he picked this morning, it really represents how I felt during those particular days and how I still feel today. It's very important to go out and help other people and not tell them what to do or how to do it, but to do, and in doing, demonstrate for someone else how they can do it too. And, so it's a very thin line we walk, but we walk it. So let me share a story with you this morning. I was thinking about, okay, what am I going to talk about? Whenever I do that, my wife just smiles at me because I go through this gyration and I start pulling books off the bookshelf and I read this and I read that. And then I guess it's about Thursday, I give up. And I put everything away and I just show up. So that's kind of what happens. So what I'm going to share with you this morning will be interesting. So go with me into this nice little community. It's a small community. I'd say maybe like, bigger than Conway, but a little smaller than that. One of the communities out there, maybe Prescott, that size of a community. So it's got one little teeny school. And there's a little boy, and he's getting ready. He's very excited. He's going to get to go to kindergarten first time, and he's just really excited about doing this. Been talking to his mom every day, kind of concerned about what he's going to wear, and finally the big day comes. He gets to go to school, and he walks into the classroom, and he's just really all excited about what's going to happen. Well, even before he gets into the classroom, they line up, because they don't go through a main door. All that's rooms have their own doors, so they line up outside of the door, and the teacher lets him into the class, and he finds his seat, and he's sitting there, and he's all excited. Oh, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. He's just really, 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 really excited. So the teacher does the roll call, you know, and does the little things that they do that very first day, and then finally she says, okay, class, today we're going to draw. And the little boy says, oh, boy, we're going to draw. I love to draw. When I'm going to draw dragons, and I'm going to draw trees and mountains and lakes and birds flying in the sky. Oh, I love to draw. And he takes his paper and he takes his little crayons and he starts drawing. And the teacher goes, wait, don't start yet. So, oh, he stops. And she says, okay, now I want you to take out a green crayon. Okay, he takes his green crayon, so he's got to turn his paper over because he's already started creating stuff. So he takes his paper and he turns it over, and she said, we're going to draw as a flower, and I'm going to do it like this. And she goes to the board, and she draws two green leaves and a green stem. And then she says, now take your red crayon, and on the top she puts a red flower, and he does exactly as he's told. Well, that was an experience. Well, he goes through that day, and they do a whole lot of other stuff. And when he gets home, his mother goes, how was school today? He says, well, it was okay, but I got a little confused. She said we were going to draw, and then she told us how we had to do it. So, but I guess that's what they do, so that's what I did. Next day, he's all excited again. He's still got that great enthusiasm. And he's lined up with the rest of the kids outside of the school door. and the teacher lets him in, and he finds a seat and he sits down, and she goes through the roll call and does all the little preliminary stuff that they have to do in the morning. And then she goes, "Today we're going to work with clay. We're going to make things with clay." And the little boy goes, "Oh boy, clay, I like working with clay. I'm going to make cars and trucks and all kinds, maybe little animals." And he starts taking his clay and pulling it into pieces and rolling little balls and doing all of this little stuff with it. And then all of a sudden the teacher goes, "Wait, don't start yet." Puts his hands together because he wants to do, so he's got to do this to keep from doing, because he wants to really mess with the clay. And then she says, "Okay, class, take your clay and roll it into a ball." So everybody does. They roll the clay into a ball. And she says, "Now take your fist and put it into the ball like so, and then do like this. We're going to make a clay ball." So once again, the little boy did exactly what he was told. Well, this went on every single day. And after a little while, that excitement that that little boy had started to diminish. But it just so happens that his dad ended up getting a job out at the site. So they moved into Richland. And now he's going to go to a big school. And he's really excited about that. He's never been in a big school before. And his father said, "You'll be fine." He even had a school bus pick him up. And he gets in the school bus, and the school bus takes him to school. And he gets out, and he looks and goes, "Wow, this big building, steps going up into a big door." And he goes up the steps, and he's in a big hallway. And he walks down this long hallway. Finally, he finds where his class is. He gets in there, and it's a young teacher. And she says, "Well, Johnny, how are you? You transferred from, what, Carnell?" And she gives him a seat, and she sits down, and she does the preliminaries that they do every morning. She takes roll call and does all of that stuff. And then finally she says, "Well, today we're going to draw." So all the kids pull their papers out, and they pull out their crayons, and they start drawing, and the little boy's sitting there with his hands folded. And the teacher's walking around the room, and she's looking at what the kids are doing, and little Johnny's still sitting there with his hands folded. And finally she gets to little Johnny's desk, and she goes, "Well, Johnny, aren't you going to draw?" He says, "Well, I was waiting for you to tell me what to draw." She says, "Well, you can draw anything you like." So he takes a green crayon, and he draws two green leaves with a green stem, and he takes a red crayon, and he draws a red flower. Now, why did I tell you that story? Because that has happened to a lot of us. And not just in a school setting, but in a spiritual sense. We're brought up believing one thing, or we go to one church and they say it's this way, or it's the highway, the low way. And we walk away holding that to be a truism. And it's hard to break that. How do we get past all of those obstacles that have been put in front of us when we're really, really small? And it always brings to me the parable where Christ says, "Suffer not the children to come unto me, because theirs is the kingdom of heaven." That innocence, that wanting to explore, that wanting to create, that wanting to just be. And it gets stifled in so, so many ways. And if we look around the world today, just as the song was perfect though, because it just really fit. Just as we look around the world today, what do we see? What does the media really focus on? It focuses on the tragedies. It focuses on the wars. It focuses on all of the negativity that's out there. Where do you find the peace? Where do you find the silence? Where do you find the time to connect with spirit when you're constantly being bombarded everything else that has to do with materialism and all the illusions, if you will, that are out there. It is difficult. It is hard. And it's a struggle. Yet, it's prophesied, and I truly believe this, and we are told by all of the great prophets, by Buddha, by Christ, by Krishna, all of them say the same thing, that no matter how far we stray, we will find the kingdom of heaven. The prodigal son always comes to mind when I think of that. It doesn't matter how many obstacles we have to go through, how many ups and downs we have to suffer, we will walk through those gates in the end. There is no other way around that. I am the Omega, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And when those words are uttered, in other words, we are all part of that. So when that comes, when we finally are all there, and I'm not just talking about our race here on this planet, but in the whole of the cosmos, because it's all God, when that finally happens, every single one of us will be the perfect person. We will have walked the gauntlet, if you will. We would have gone through all of the ups and all of the downs. And how many lifetimes we have to do that, will it take to do that? I have no idea. But we will be there. That will happen. I can guarantee that for you. Absolutely guarantee. And I'm truly far from being perfect. I go up and down all the time. But I always seek spirit. I always seek that oneness. I always seek the light. I always try to find the true path. Even in traffic. And over the years, I have gotten better at traffic. That's my yardstick, if you will. If I can go through traffic and not get upset or want to cuss at someone, I'm doing good. That's my yardstick. Truly. That's how I know how I'm doing. When I go through traffic and every little thing starts to put me on edge, I go, okay, Chris. Generally, I find a place to pull over and I just kind of get still. I have to recenter myself again. I have to get back on track. How do we become perfect? How do we become the super person, the super being? By constantly picking ourselves up every time we fall. And trust me, we will fall a lot. We will fall a lot. I can't tell you how many times I've fallen in just this one lifetime. And I can't tell you how many times more I will probably fall. But every time I do, I will pick myself back up. I will forgive myself. Okay, because that's one of the hardest things that we have to do, is to forgive ourselves. When we know we have crossed the line, we did it, we justified it, we went through all of these little thoughts and things, and we're really good at doing that, about justifying our actions. And we know we took an action that we shouldn't have taken, but we took it anyway. And now that we're over here, we're going, ah, I know I shouldn't have done that. Oh, they don't want me now. Oh, all right. You have to forgive yourself so that you can cross back over. You've got to do that. You've got to pick yourself up. You're the one that can do that, but you'll be glad you did. You'll be glad you did. We're down here learning, and to become perfect, which we will be, it's going to take more than one lifetime. It's going to take falling off the old wagon a lot of time, getting back up on it, if I remember right, wasn't it two thieves that were on the crosses next to Christ? Yeah. A murderer, right? Yeah. And what happened with them? They got their stuff together right there on the cross. So never, ever, ever despair. Never, ever give up hope on yourself, because you truly are a spiritual being. You truly are that. Yes, you have a physical body, but the reality is you've had lots of physical bodies. This is just the model you're in this time. You'll get another one. But you're a spiritual being. You'll always be a spiritual being. And you're on the path to perfection. So I guess I got kind of heavy this morning. I am going to be doing a workshop on death and dying. And it's, I guess I shouldn't call it a workshop. It really is more of a discussion. And that will be next Saturday. I will be in Laconia next Friday speaking to Laconia High School. And I'll be back that evening and here Saturday at 1 o'clock. I'm doing that with a friend of mine. Her name is Lipa. She's a therapist. And when we do that workshop together, we kind of offset each other really well, because she's very factual. So I can't say this is a fact, because she'll go, how do you know? So it's a real nice combination, if you will, of approaching the fact of death and dying. So if you can make it to that, I would suggest that you do. And let me read this from the, it's not Upanishads, but it's very close to that. This is interesting. In the Upanishads and the Bhagavad Gita, it's from the Bhagavad Gita, were both, I believe, written before the Bible was written. It goes, sages do not grieve for the living, nor the dead. Never did I not exist, nor you, nor those rulers of men, nor any one of us ever hereafter cease to be. Let me read it one more time, because I believe they're very, very insightful words. Sages do not grieve for the living, nor the dead. Never did I not exist, nor you, nor these rulers of men, nor will any one of us ever hereafter cease to be. So I will close with the great invocation, because I've gotten into the habit of saying this a lot now. From the point of light, within the mind of God, let light stream forth into the minds of men. Let light descend on earth. From the point of love within the heart of God, let love stream forth into the hearts of men. May Christ return to earth. From the center, where the will of God is known, let purpose guide the little wills of men. The purpose which the Master knows and serves. From the center, which we call the race of man, let the plan of love and light work out. May it seal the door where evil dwells. Let light and love and power restore the plan on earth. Namaste.
Christopher set us up with such a sacred energy at this moment. Doesn't it feel wonderful? Let's utilize that sacred energy and that love that we share for one another, that light that's beginning to burn, burn brighter, and connect in with our higher power, whatever that is for you, as we prepare for communion. Join me in prayer, please. Loving Spirit of Light, as we partake of this, help us to recognize the physical form as a vehicle that carries the love and light within us. Help us to find ways to do worthy work, worthy offering, worthy blessings, so that not only does our light shine brighter, but that we rekindle the light in others. Walk with us in all things. These things we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. If you're new to the Divine Fellowship, go ahead. We have unleavened bread if you like the tradition of that. Animal crackers if you want to honor Native American pathway. And then this little cup is gluten-free. So whatever works for you works for us. Many blessings. As that continues around, would you join me in prayer again, please? Loving Spirit of Light, as we drink this in, help us to drink in life, all of it. There are things that we prefer, they were other ways. Help us to find peace. There are things that our hands can do, give us the courage to do them. Walk with us, bless us, and guide us. Nourish us spiritually. These things we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
You know, I also dare say that we're the only church in the universe that uses a crystalline rock structure under the cross with a dream catcher. Any volunteers? Oh, okay. You volunteered a week or two ago.
Yeah, I know, but I forgot to say something more.
Oh, okay.
I'll let you hold that okay. For a minute. Like I said, I'm the treasurer, but I wanted to remind people that if you do long-form taxes that and you give cash, there are some donation envelopes that if you want me to keep track of that, so at the end of the year or the beginning of the next year, I can send you a notice as to what you have contributed, because it is tax deductible. And so forth. And those of you that saw me handing out envelopes this morning, that's what I was handing out, was last year's tax information. So just a reminder, if you write checks, I do keep that information, and I do start a sheet for you. And if you contribute more than $50, you will get one. If it doesn't add up to $50, I usually don't send it unless you specifically call me and say, hey, I want it. But anyway, I just wanted to remind you that you can do that. And again, Amazon, make sure it's smileamazon.com, because that one you can contribute as a donation. Amazon will donate to your charity of choice, and the Divine Fellowship is listed. So that is one of the ones to do.
Also through work.
Oh, yeah, through work, United Way. We are part of that campaign also. I know Hanford employees, they've already done theirs for the year. That's done in like in November or October or something. So probably have to do that again in October this year. But anything you can give, it helps. It helps keep this building going. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, because we spent about $300 this week for Superior Tree to come in and do some work in the parking lot.
Ice,
so,
ice melt. And maybe more to come.
More to come.
Whatever. Sandra had surgery this week. So there's get well cards. If you want to sign it, send a little note to her. That'd be just great. So I'm going to send those around. And one other little piece of business here. We have a communion set up every Sunday. You know, we're just a bunch of volunteers. So if you have an opportunity to come in just a few minutes early and help out, if you could sign up for communion for February, that would just be awesome. So I'm going to send that around as well. Let's start that over here. Put your name and phone number so that you can be contacted, reminded, and if you have any questions about that process. Any other business I need to take care of at this point? Let's do a guided meditation then, shall we? Oh, look.